And here we go.
Your life is your life. Know it while you have it.
My life in photography really evolved out of my childhood influences. I grew up in a very artistic home. There was a lot of artistic activity, painting, music, theatre, books. And we were encouraged to paint and to draw and to play musical instruments. And I think it had a big impact on me when I was growing up. My father was an actor. He worked in the theatre in London and in New York. He made films in Britain and in Hollywood. And in fact, some of my earliest memories are of sitting on the side of the London stage watching him working. My mother is a landscape painter, and she introduced us to the great painters, to the great composers and musicians, and to the great writers. So it was a really interesting cultural mix when I was growing up. But this was the 60s. I was 13, 14 years old, and there was a cultural revolution happening. So as well as Beethoven, Dvořák, Elgar, there was also Jimi Hendrix and the Doors, as well as looking at Van Gogh and Kandinsky and Constable and Turner. I was listening to Miles Davis, to John Coltrane, to Leonard Cohen, the Beatles, the Stones. So it was a fascinating time to be absorbing all this new cultural material. In the mid-1970s, I studied fine art at Newcastle University. And then after leaving university, I went straight to music college and studied the drums. And I had a brief career as a professional musician. The transition from painting and music into photography took place in a Moroccan circus in 1982. I'd been offered a job there playing drums, and I took the job not for the musical possibilities but for the photographic possibilities. I just had this feeling that it could be a really interesting place to start taking photographs. So almost unconsciously and by accident, my career as a portrait photographer began photographing circus acts. And I took one photograph of a Spanish trapeze artist, which worked beautifully as a graphic image, as an expression of what the circus is about. And it was that photograph and a few others, which I found on contact sheets, which gave me the confidence to think that I could possibly do this as a profession. And it's interesting when you see my very early circus pictures and then you come right through 36 years later to what I'm doing today, you can see the similarities. And I am without any doubt drawn to portraiture. There was a significant shift after I worked in the circus to photographing actors and actresses. And it was a technical shift as well as an aesthetic shift. So I moved from a handheld 35mm camera using available light to using a Hasselblad on a tripod using studio lights. So the pictures became more formal. And the first actress I photographed was Dame Wendy Hiller. I photographed her in profile. I used quite an unusual lighting plot in that I lit her from behind so that she's facing off in that direction. I bring the light in from the back of her head. The light then bounces into a reflector, and so the light is reflected into her face. And I felt that the most flattering light would be the softest light I could achieve. I then moved from Wendy Hiller to Paul Scofield, and in fact the two of them worked together as husband and wife in one of the most important films to come out of the 1960s, a film called A Man for All Seasons. And Paul Scofield won the Oscar for that film, and Wendy Hiller was nominated for Best Supporting Actress. To photograph Paul Scofield was one of the turning points for me in my career. He arrived at my studio, and he did a very interesting thing when he arrived. He looked at all the pictures on the walls, and for a British man, that is almost unheard of. And then he sat down, he said, "Nicholas, make me a cup of tea. And once I've had the tea, if you want me to stand on my head, I will stand on my head." And of course, what he really meant was, "I will give myself to the session." And he did. He gave himself 100%. He's very focused, very present, and very committed to the portrait session, and it really shows. After that, I photographed Alec Guinness, Greg Wise, Josette Simon, John Mills. So between the circus and the artists, there was this period when I was photographing British actors. And it was during that period that I really learned how to use studio lights and how to work in a more controlled way, where with the circus, it was very spontaneous. You really didn't know what was going to happen. Things were happening so quickly. Lights, music, costume, animals. It was an environment where you were forced to work very quickly, to react very quickly, where in the studio it was much more measured. You could take your time, you could make decisions in a more calculated way. I've always worked in series in my career, right from the very beginning. And the longest series of pictures I've made has been of British artists, portraits of British artists. And it began in 1987, more or less by accident, actually. And photographed an artist called Cuffin Williams, a landscape and portrait painter. I photographed him in his studio against one of his own pieces of work, an oil painting of Welsh mountains in a very turbulent kind of sky. And what I was trying to do in the portrait was to get the connection between the artist and the work, to see the similarities. So that when you look at the picture and then you look at the background of the picture, you get the sense that it's what's in the artist's mind. And that picture went into the National Portrait Gallery's permanent collection quite soon after I took it. And then the second artist I photographed was John Piper. And again, a landscape painter, wonderful landscape painter, one of Britain's best. I photographed him late in life. And I was really struck by the kind of haunting, spiritual quality of his expression. It was almost as if he was half in the spirit world already. He died several years later, but when I photographed him, I think he was in his late 80s, it was as though part of him was in the real world and part of him was off in a different world. And it was his expression that really struck me. So I moved him close and just included his head and concentrated on the eye. So you get this very strong expression into the camera. And then in the early 1990s, I began the most intensive period of photographing artists that I ever went through. And the second artist I photographed was Anthony Cairo, one of the most important British sculptors. I photographed him in his North London studio against a white wall. I placed him quite low in the composition. And above him was a series of iron hoops suspended by a bracket at the top of the picture and then coming down either side of him. So you've got one hoop coming right down into the line of his eyebrows, one just across the top of his head, another one coming down to his shoulder, so that wherever your eye is in the composition, it always leads back to the man himself. And because he had a strong, intense gaze into the camera, I knew that I could get away with pulling back and including a lot of the studio in the composition. With Peter Blake, one of Britain's best-known pop artists, I used a waxwork in the photograph and also two Japanese sumo wrestlers. And I used them because, as a pop artist, Peter Blake is using elements of popular culture and sport and pop music and fashion are all things that he brings into his work. And there was a lovely story he told me when I was doing the portrait. Sonny Liston had just lost the heavyweight title fight to Muhammad Ali, and he knew that the waxwork in Madame Tussauds would become redundant. So he phoned them up and he said, "Can I have it?" And they said, "Yes." I mean, that would never happen today. But in the 1960s, they were obviously more relaxed, and they said, "Yeah." So he borrowed a van from a friend and he went and picked up this life-size waxwork of this heavyweight boxing champion and put it in his studio. And I turned up 25 years later and there it was. And when he walked into the room, it was really impressive. I mean, bigger than both of us. It appears smaller in the portrait, but in real life it was considerably bigger. So I placed the artist between the waxwork of the boxer and the two sumo wrestlers. With Gillian Ayres, which is one of my favorite portraits, and I think she's one of the great British abstract painters, I place her in front of one of her own abstract paintings. She's holding a cigarette. She smoked continually throughout the session. So I thought, well, use the cigarette. You know, so I kind of got her to position it so that it worked graphically. As soon as I walked into the studio, I saw this chair encrusted with oil paint. I think she'd had it for decades and it had just gradually got more and more and more covered in oil paint. So I used it in the foreground of the picture as a kind of graphic structure. So you've got the chair, the artist, the cigarette, and then the background. So when I'm composing photographs, I'm thinking not just of the expression, not just of the contact with the eyes and the face, but of every square millimeter of the photograph. Every square millimeter of the portrait is important for me, and I'm trying to make everything work and everything gel so that it all coalesces together. Coming much more up to date, very end of 2013, I took what I think is one of the best portraits I ever took of an artist called Celia Paul. She's a figurative artist, a portrait painter. She has a wonderful, very atmospheric, very austere studio overlooking the British Museum in London. And as soon as I walked in, I knew that the setting was wonderful and that it would give me a really magical portrait. And she did something interesting. She withdrew into her own inner world in this portrait. Sometimes people are very upfront, they're very present, they're very concentrated on the lens. Other people create a barrier, and Celia Paul just withdrew into this other world, but it worked really well because of the austerity and the very subdued pastel colours of the studio. And because she remained very still throughout the portrait session, she wasn't moving around, she wasn't talking, I was able to make a double exposure. So the camera was on the tripod, I made the exposure, I then removed the back, wound the camera on and shifted the position of the tripod and then put the camera back on and made a second exposure. This was shot on analog, on film, so I didn't know what I was going to get, and it was a complete surprise to me, but a very interesting surprise, and it just showed me how chance can come into the creative process, and chance does and should come into the creative process. It's a really important part of it. So I was able to get a slightly magical portrait. And then one of the more recent ones was taken here in Berlin of one of Germany's best painters, Jonathan Mieser. Really wild looking, intense, brilliant painter in my opinion. I placed him against one of his own portraits of himself. And although when you look at the portrait, you're not immediately aware that it's a self-portrait because it's balanced really between representation and abstraction, there are nevertheless clues that this is a portrait of the artist. In the mid-1990s, my career took a change of direction. And it really happened after a chance encounter in Brighton. I was walking into a cafe, and as I was walking in, a young man called Ralph was walking out. And it was one of those moments, as a portrait photographer, where you know 100% instinctively this is somebody you have to photograph. And when he came to the studio, and when I looked at him through the viewfinder, I realized for the first time that he had an almost perfectly symmetrical face. Most people don't. Most people have got one eye bigger than the other, or the mouth is off to the left or right. But Ralph's features were so even, I thought instead of going against the symmetry, I would go with it. And I did this by placing his nose ring exactly in the center of the photograph. And in fact, if you draw a diagonal line, top left down to bottom right, top right down to bottom left, where the lines intersect, they pass straight through the nose ring. And he had such an extraordinary face that I knew I could let the face fill the entire frame. And that's what I did. Soon after that, I had a phone call from Brighton Museum, and they asked me if I would make the photographs for an exhibition on fetishism. And because I already had one photograph that I felt confident with, I realized that this was something I could do, and so I accepted their offer. And the second person I photographed was Fabian, dressed as the Angel of Death. And I remember him coming to the studio, and he swept in a full-length fake fur coat as if he was Marlene Dietrich, and then he opened the coat to reveal this leather outfit. It was black leather with zips, with straps, with a headpiece, with piercings in his face, in his ears and in his nipples, and wings as well. And this really gave me my second strong photograph for the exhibition. I found a Dutchman called Dickie Dick, who had a full body tattoo, literally head to foot. And I was told at the time that this was quite rare. There were only about 10 people in the world with literally complete head to foot body tattoos. I photographed a woman called Polly, who at the time was one of the most photographed fetish models in London. And she was wearing a design by Anthony Gregory, what he described as medieval body armor. I assumed that I would photograph her from the front, but when she turned round and I saw the design from the back, I realized that this would make a much stronger, much more graphic image. It was as if the spine had been lifted out from under the skin and placed on the surface of the skin. I photographed a wonderful woman called Christine Bateman, who at the time was modeling for the German artist Lucien Freud. And she told me Freud had booked her every morning and every afternoon between now and Christmas, but that she had one Tuesday afternoon that she could offer me. And I said, I will be there. And I went to her North London apartment, and for the portrait, I placed her in the doorway of her bedroom. She had covered the bedroom walls with mirrored panels to give the sense of expanded space. And she'd also put mirrors on the door. And by very carefully moving the door, I was able to create a triptych within the photograph. So you have the real Christine Bateman in the center, and then to her left and to her right, you have reflections. So you've got three different versions of the subject. I photographed another Dutchman called Mark, who had what looked like a leopard or a cheetah tattooed on the left-hand side of his face. So I moved in close so that his head fills the entire frame. And I asked him to close his eyes. And I did this because I felt that if his eyes were open, the viewer would be drawn to his expression, where if his eyes were closed, you would travel more evenly across the whole photograph. I'm very conscious when I'm taking photographs of how the viewer's eye will travel, the journey it will take, and the way I can guide that journey. And I think of it not just as a visual journey, but also as an emotional, psychological journey. I knew that I wanted a Mohican in the series. And to photograph a Mohican at its best, it should be made in profile. So I needed somebody not just with a really good Mohican, but also with a good profile. And I found a woman called Jed Phoenix, who has a beautiful, slightly Egyptian profile. And I knew when I first met her that she would work perfectly for the photograph. And even the ring in her lower lip adds a little accent to the picture. And an interesting thing happened. I put down the photograph of Jed next to the photograph that I'd taken of Wendy Hiller almost 8 years earlier. And I realized that they were more or less the same photograph. Same camera, same lens, same camera to subject distance, and also a similar mood. And it occurred to me that I was using the same classical portrait techniques for these people as I had done 8 or 10 years earlier for the actors and the actresses. Because I've always worked in series, the natural way of presenting a series is in book form, where when you work with magazines and newspapers, you may get a single picture or a double page or 4 or 6 pages. With a book, you're working with 20, 30, 40, 50 pictures. My first book came out in 1996, and that was a culmination of the work I had done with people with body piercings and tattooings. I published a book on the Italian performance artist, Franco B. I'd met Franco when I was working on the chameleon body photographs. And we spent 3 years working together, collaborating. I was photographing his performances. 2 years after that, I published a book called Crossing the Water, which was a series of landscape photographs taken on the perimeter of a small lake in southern England. I photographed the lake at different times of day, under different weather conditions, different seasons. And I started in January and worked right through till December. So it was a whole year just on a small lake. My book after that was on Berlin. And I was working in Berlin in that period when the renovation was beginning. It then intensified after I finished the book, and a lot of what is in the book has now disappeared. But I was photographing the graffiti, the walls, the skin of the city. That was followed by a book called Five Cities. And I decided to take 5 European cities. It was Istanbul, Palermo, Berlin, Paris, and Budapest. And each city would have 5 interrelated photographs. And I got the idea from a wonderful film called Night on Earth by Jim Jarmusch, where he takes 5 taxi rides. He films 5 independent taxi rides in 5 different cities all simultaneously. And it's a film I love. I mean, I love Jim Jarmusch's work. And I thought I would apply the same principle, but to a book of photographs. So in Budapest, I found these extraordinary public telephones. In Palermo, I found a small park, a Garibaldi park. And I found a banyan tree, in fact, a series, 3 or 4 banyan trees with intertwined branches and tree trunks. And in Berlin, I went to the Mauer Park, to an iron bridge, and I found a series of faces, just in white outline, profiles, close-ups of eyes, full face. And so I made a series of those and published the book in 2010. And the book is called Five Cities. I've recently been working with the German fashion designer Florian Schulz. And what attracted me to Florian's work was the way he draws inspiration from different cultures and from different centuries. He takes you on these wonderful visual journeys, and you never really know where you're going with him. You could, for example, be in ancient Egypt during the reign of Cleopatra. Or you could be in a Grace Jones video in New York in the 1980s. Or in a production of A Midsummer Night's Dream. And I think it was this challenge of not knowing, of photographing a very wide visual imagination that I found so interesting. To achieve this degree of simplicity in the photographs takes time and it takes attention. I give a lot of thought to the way the light is falling on the face and on the garments. I look at the graphics of the photograph. I'm interested in the way the lines work and how the garment fits the body. And I'm concerned also with backgrounds, how the subject stands out against the background. So that when you look at the final photograph, everything seems to fall naturally into place. It just feels instinctively right. Hair and makeup are crucial in these kind of photo shoots, accentuating the eyes and the mouth so that you're aware not just of the fashion, but also of the character of the model herself. And you need to achieve a balance between the two things. And I knew that I wanted a different kind of atmosphere in the photographs. So as well as shooting on digital, I was also working with a vintage Polaroid camera from the 1970s. And I was using deliberately long shutter speeds, sometimes as long as 8 or 10 seconds, so that you get this sense of movement in the photographs. And that means that when the viewer is looking at the final image, there's a sense of movement, and that helps their imagination to travel off in a different direction. Because Florian's work is so dramatic, so theatrical, I knew that we needed a model who could carry the drama, who had conviction and who had poise. And we found a wonderful, beautiful Chilean model called Macarena, and she was perfect for these designs. And there was a lovely soulfulness as well in her expression. I think of the great models as being like dancers or actors. They arrest our attention, they heighten our awareness of the image, they bring something special to a photo shoot, and this is why they're so interesting to work with. When I'm editing a photo shoot, the first thing I'm looking for is the expression in the eyes. For me, it's the single most important element in a portrait. It's that moment when you connect. It's when there's a sense of recognition, and that's what makes a portrait, I think, so compelling. We bring our own memory and our own personal history to the moment. And when you get it right in a photograph, it's a very powerful thing.